السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're still talking about our second visit to Iraq in 1997 for doing the Kobani project. On the way out, after we completed the mission successfully, alhamdulillah, and my back was hurting me, we decided to hire not the ordinary taxi to take us from Baghdad to Amman, but actually something, the big car called GEMS. GEMS is a big, huge car. And to use it as like an ambulance, so I can sleep all the way between Baghdad till we reach Amman. And it was myself, Abdul Wahid, and Anwar, and we arrived safely, alhamdulillah, to Amman, and we went to stay in the same hotel that we used all the time. And astonishingly, during that weekend, especially, it was the holiday for actually the Christian holiday for Sham al-Nasim, or what do you call it, Easter holiday. Amman was closed, no activity, nothing, and we were stuck for the first day. And then we started to have some crazy ideas. Palestine is not far from Amman, and we started to ask the receptionist, how can we go to Palestine? Said, yeah, there's something called the bridge of Sheikh Hussein. Go there and take a car, it will take you inside Palestine. And we took the advice and we left all our luggage there and took small luggage with us and went to hire a car from the car parking place, the station there, and went to the border area between Jordan and the state of Palestine stroke Israel. And the Jordanian police officer, you know what he told us? Where are you going? He said, we're going to Jerusalem. He looked at our faces. Oh my God. People with beard, and three of you, young people, going there. Inshallah, within 1 hour or two, you come back to me, I'll be waiting for you. He said, okay, no problem. Let us try. We took the risk. And when we arrived to the checkpoint at the border of Palestine stroke Israel, and the police officer, she was a woman, was checking everything with us. And Anwar had a Pakistani passport, Abdul Wahid has a Dutch passport, and they had a British passport. And with the Pakistani passport, you should not stamp the entry visa on it, but we requested her to give him on a piece of paper. And she checked all our luggage, and some of our friends was giving the gold of their sisters and aunties and to take it with us to UK. And the woman was not very suspecting us, because at that time was the Oslo Treaty and the peace and Yasser Arafat and. And she asked about the gold. We were very frank and very transparent with her. We said that we are going to be there for a day or two, because it's holiday in Amman, and we're going to visit the Jerusalem and come back and pray and come back. She trusted us in spite of the fact of the stereotype face of our faces. We took a car and we drove to Jerusalem. Beautiful feeling, aspiration, inspiration for you when you found yourself surrounded by the history of Jerusalem, the history of Islam, and the history, beautiful history of this area. And we went to one of those youth hostels, the three of us, was very cheap, and we had it before. We had it from some of our friends, and we prayed in Jerusalem, alhamdulillah, and went around the old city, shopping and seeing and talking to people, very, very joyful. I forget about the pain in my back. Then the second day, I remembered my brother who lives in Hebron, Al-Khalil. And one of the brothers, Anwar, I can't remember, Anwar Abdullah, told me, we want to go and pray in Hebron Mosque, Maqam Sayyidina Ibrahim. I said, no problem. I have a brother there from a Nietzsche family. Family is a big family in the whole of Palestine, very well known. Abdul Ghani called. His name was Abdul Ghani. So we took a car, hired a car, and we went there. And at every checkpoint, there was a humiliation for all the Palestinians trying to travel from A to B to C. So they actually make a checkpoint at every border or at every 5 or 10 kilometers to unload your luggage. And the woman has to cross, the children has to cross, and everybody has to cross Gaza. Complete humiliation. Till we arrived there, and we told the driver, please, do you know anybody from the Natcha family? He said, of course, Natcha family is a huge family. And I know somebody who have a pharmacy here. Let us go and see him. We went to the pharmacy, and they went there, and I told him, I want to see my colleague, Abdul Ghani. He said, Dr. Abdul Ghani? He said, yes. He said, okay, just wait a minute. Who are you? I said, my name is Dr. Elbana. He rang Dr. Abdul Ghani at home. And his wife could not be able to take it or to realize or to believe that Hani al-Banna is in Hebron. And she came rushing to be sure that I am Hani al-Banna or somebody else. And when she looked at me, she was screaming, Dr. Banna, how are you? Then her husband came, Abdul Ghani. Abdul Ghani was one of those people who are dignified, credible, intelligent, Yani was a man of value, a man which is very, very, very knowledgeable and clever and honest. And he took us to stay the night in his house. And he fed us and he took us around. He fed us nicely and went to the Islamic hospital and to see the old town and see the market area, which was nearly closed because the prayer in Masjid al-Khalil was not there, and there's no market around the area. And we stayed there for a day and a half, and he gave us a lift till and even give us some gifts, souvenir from the area. So we went to Jerusalem the second day. After spending the night there and visiting Hebron al-Khalil, alhamdulillah, with this kind of joyful feeling that I am here, Prophet Ibrahim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to make a salatu wa salam alayka wa sallam, wa salamu alayka ya Ibrahim al-Khalil, ya Aba al-Anbiya. And we stayed in the same youth hostel in Jerusalem when we arrived there, and we said, okay, let us stay the whole night today and take the car in the morning to go to the border and from the border to Amman, inshallah. But something dubious came to myself, said, why do we should stay the night here? We might miss our flight. This was the devil. Let us pray Maghrib and Isha and take the car and rush, stay overnight in Amman to guarantee that we can actually catch our flight. We were praying Isha there after Isha Adhan. And in the second or third rak'ah, I found myself when I was making sujood. I cried and cried and cried. I didn't know why I cried. There's nothing to make me cry. I realized that Al-Aqsa was telling me, why you are leaving me alone? Why you're not staying for another prayer in the Fajr and go after Fajr? We did not realize the message from Al-Aqsa. We took the car after Isha prayer to the border. You know what? The border was closed at 12. And we arrived at 12:05, and we have to stay the night in the car, in no man's land, actually, at the border between Amman and the border of Palestine at that time. The lesson here is, we took the risk to go to visit Jerusalem, Al-Quds, and to visit Hebron, Al-Khalil, because this is something which was a dream for every one of us. Alhamdulillah, successful. The second thing is, actually, don't undermine the barakah and the karama of Masjid al-Aqsa. I did not understand the weeping message which came to me when I was doing my second rak'ah or the third rak'ah of Isha. And next time, when you go to these places, don't rush. Stay as a good manner and good respect to the places that you are visiting. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.